Welcome back, mineralogy fans. It's time to finish our survey of the silicate minerals that tend to form in the metamorphic rocks. Talc is the softest of all minerals, so I'll start with the stuff we put on babies' butts. The most diagnostic property of this mineral is that when you touch it, it feels like soap. In fact, it is the main constituent of what we call soapstone. With a hardness of 1, your fingernail will easily gouge into this soft mineral. While it can be white to gray to black and even green, it leaves a white, colorless streak. It has one direction of cleavage, but honestly, crystals rarely grow in a way to display this very well, and the soft, soapy feel is really the most diagnostic property. It often forms as a hydrothermal alteration of mafic igneous rocks, or alteration of silica-rich dolomite, both being good sources of magnesium and silica and void of aluminum. Though there is a concern about exposure to large amounts of talc dust linked to lung cancer, normal moderate use should pose no risk, especially since it was realized that asbestos fibers were getting into talcum powder back in the old days, and we now remove the asbestos before putting it on market to put on your baby's butt, so no worries there. So one use is as an absorbent, but the variety of uses of this mineral is quite staggering. Got something made of rubber or plastic? Yeah, it probably has talc in it. You ingest it as a food additive and a component of pharmaceuticals. It's important in the ceramics industry, paint manufacture, and paper making. Does your kid like crayons? Thank talc. And every time you pick up talc and feel that soapy feel, remember, it's a part of some soaps. It can also serve as a solid lubricant in very cold environments. But these metamorphic silicates are not made in cold environments, and due to the geothermal gradient, as rocks get buried deeper and deeper, they get hotter and hotter, and the pressure gets greater and greater. Chlorite is a relatively low-temperature, low-pressure index mineral, which is one of the few minerals in which we can use color as a diagnostic property. Chlorite is a forest green color, and its name is Greek for a green rock. Chlorite is also distinctively soft, though not as soft as talc. Chlorite only comes in at 2 to 2.5 and so can usually be scratched with your fingernail. Though green in color, it leaves a colorless streak. Like the micas, it has one preferred direction of cleavage, but the crystals are rarely large enough to see this feature, just like talc. Instead, chlorite forming in metamorphic rocks is one of the main reasons for rocks to be green. Green schist is a chlorite-rich metamorphic schist formed at relatively low temperature and pressure. There are no significant uses of this mineral except as a soft filler. As burial continues of our metamorphic rocks and temperature and pressure increases, garnets begin to form. Color in garnets is not distinctive as it can be brown, green, orange, yellow, even white or black or colorless. But its most common variety is almandine garnet with its pomegranate red color. In fact, the name garnet comes from the old French granat, from the Latin granatum, which means pomegranate. More characteristic of garnet is its tendency to form in equidimensional balls that are often 12-sided. That's a dodecahedron to you role-playing game fans. But if it breaks, it acts like quartz and fractures conchoidally or irregularly. It is a bit denser than quartz at about 3.5 to 4, but has a similar hardness at about 7. This hardness explains many of its main uses as an abrasive, or as water jet cutting abrasive blasting material. Crushed garnet can be used for water filtration as well. The next index mineral on our trip down into the earth are a group of aluminosilicates which make up an interesting triple junction with the three species depending on temperature and pressure. All three minerals can be said to have the basic formula of Al2SSO5, and just rearrange the elements to make polymorphs, which is a term for minerals with the same chemical formula but a different crystal structure. The best source of aluminosilicate material is mud, so shale or mudstone is a major precursor of this rock, and tropical soils will provide this chemistry best via a mineral precursor called bauxite. This diagram shows that kyanite tends to form at lower metamorphic temperatures at a range of pressure. Andalusite forms at low pressure and low to moderate temperature, and sillimanite occurs at high temperature across a wide range of pressure. Kyanite is identified mainly by the vitreous to pearly blue blades it makes. The hardness depends on if you scratch it along the blade axis or perpendicular. Parallel to the long axis of the blades, the hardness is only 4.5 to 5, but perpendicular to this direction, the hardness increases to 6.5 to 7. In fact, this mineral used to be called disthene, meaning two strengths, but its current name, kyanite, is now official and comes from the Greek kuanos, meaning dark blue. As one might guess from the rod shape, this mineral has two preferred directions of cleavage at 79-degree angles to each other. Andalusite is the Al2SiO5 polymorph that forms at lower pressure and mid-range temperature. The color is usually reddish-brown to pink, though other colors are possible. But all are generally vitreous luster with a hardness around 7, and a crystal habit that forms pillars with square ends. Occasionally, this mineral will twin, causing interpenetration of two of these four-sided pillars. There is one good direction of cleavage and one poor at about right angles. It was first described at a location in Andalusia, Spain, hence its name of andalusite. I guess it should be pronounced andalusite. Sillimanite, named after U.S. chemist Benjamin Silliman, is the Al2SiO5 polymorph that forms at high temperature and a wide range of pressure. It is a vitreous to silky luster mineral with a hardness of around 7 and a prismatic crystal habit, meaning pencil-like. It has one perfect direction of cleavage, but its fibrous nature means it fractures in splinter-like fibers. It is usually colorless, but impurities can make it white or gray and less commonly other colors. Because these three minerals come out at different temperatures and pressures, they are very rarely found together. Their identical chemistry keeps the density of these minerals around 3.5, a little denser than normal, but not too diagnostic. The aluminum-rich aspect of the kyanite, andalusite, sillimanite system means they are all used as a source of refractory aluminum in metallurgy work. A refractory mineral is one that adds strength and durability to metal alloys. They are also used in glass and ceramic manufacture and occasionally as gemstones. Speaking of gemstones, metamorphism and some igneous processes can produce a mineral group called tourmaline, from the Sinhalese tourmali or thermali, which referred to some gemstones from Sri Lanka. This is one of the most complicated silicate groups out there. It is a cyclosilicate, making rings out of the silica tetrahedra, and there is a broad variety of elements that can bond this together isomorphically, that is, with the same crystal form, with different chemistry. But from this chemical stew, we get three main types: schorl, dravite, and elbite, each named after the place they were first best known. Schorl is by far the most common tourmaline and is a brown to black, sodium iron-rich variety typically found in igneous granites or granite pegmatites. The second is magnesium-rich dravite, which shows up in metamorphic schists and marbles. The last is the lithium-rich form called elbite, which is the form valued for its transparency and colors. In general, tourmalines have a vitreous luster, though some dark forms can be dull. They have a hardness around 7 to 7.5, giving them the needed durability for gemstones, and a specific gravity from 2.9 to 3.3. The most obvious feature are the prismatic crystals, pencil-shaped with heavily striated surfaces. The elongated prisms often show three sides, which is quite unique. All tourmalines are piezoelectric, which gives them one other use besides as gemstones and collector specimens in high-pressure gauges. There is some evidence that the Sinhalese word tourmali meant a crystal that can attract volcanic ash. This might be true, and it may be partly due to one other odd property called pyroelectricity, which is the ability to hold a temporary voltage when the mineral as a whole has been taken to a new temperature. The final silicate mineral we will look at comes out at the medium to high temperature and pressure ranges of metamorphism. One of the most striking aspects of this mineral is its tendency to twin two crystal habits into interpenetrating crosses. In fact, the name, staurolite, comes from the Greek staros, meaning cross. It is classically a dark brown or reddish-brown color with a subvitreous to resinous luster. The hardness is 7 to 7.5, specific gravity around 3.5, and has one good direction of cleavage. Starlight doesn't have much use. It used to be used for an abrasive, but other more common minerals are more likely now. So its main use is by geologists, as an index mineral to tell us we have gotten to some higher levels of metamorphism. And with the beautiful interpenetrating starlight, we end our tour of the most common and useful silicate minerals. Again, there are about 4,000 minerals, and over 90% of them are silicates. So we have only covered what is most needed by the beginning geologist. When we come back next time, we begin looking at the non-silicate minerals, starting with the carbonates.